Hey, this is Jason Dillon, pastor at Parkway Church, and I'm so glad you joined this Parkway podcast for powerful inspiration and purposeful insights. I believe this podcast will lift your spirit and lead you into the future God has prepared for you. Enjoy the message. Hey everyone, thank you for joining us today for this Parkway Church podcast. I'm Pastor Jason Dillon, and I count it a great privilege and an honor to communicate to you today the wonderful, invaluable truths of the Word of God. And just this past week, it was as though God handed me an urgent news bulletin. You know, you've seen reporters, news reporters, and they will be in prime time, live on television, and all of a sudden they may make an announcement, this just in, breaking news, and they'll deliver that news. Well, I feel like God dealt with me this past week and really wanted me to communicate to His church an important truth from the Word of God. And so I want you to look at Romans chapter 4, verse 3. The Bible says, for what says the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. Now, this is powerful. Look at that a little more closely. Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him individual application for righteousness. It was not counted to them. God began to deal with me about our response to God's Word. You see, righteousness is a person in right standing in response to their obedience to God's Word. And as human beings, we each have a responsibility. Paul picks up on this individual response to God in Romans 12, verse 3, when he says, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Every man is given the measure of faith. Well, why? Because Hebrews later tells us that without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So if every individual is supposed to seek God, every man must be given that starter. Just like ladies of old, when they would cook bread, they would have something called a yeast starter. It would be something that generates. God put in us a generating force called faith that every person is born with. And it is the means to believe God's Word in spite of circumstantial evidence, in spite of what we see around us. It is an innate trust that says, I trust God that He will come through. You see, when God created the world, He created Adam and Eve, and they were literally His children, full-grown children of God the Father. And God gave to them His Word, and He expected them to live it, to follow it, but they did not do what they were supposed to do. You see, as parents, we are to teach our children the ways of God by visibly and verbally instructing them. Well, God did just this. He visibly and verbally instructed His children. He walked with them in the cool of the day. He instructed them on what they should and should not do. And yet, even God, in the most perfect home setting possible, crafted and created by God, did not have children that obeyed and followed Him. And this was a part of this last week's motivation. I begin to think about precious parents who have children who have walked away from the faith their parents displayed to them. They walked away from the dedication mom and dad showed them how to have, and they essentially said, I don't share a desire or the same level of dedication. And what a heartbreak that must be whenever a parent sees their child walking away from God. Well, I want you to know that our God, Jesus Christ, He knows what you're going through, because God experienced that rejection of His will, His Word, and His ways from His very own children in the most perfect, optimum setting that's ever been created. You see, the Bible says in Deuteronomy 6 verse 4 that we're to teach our children, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one Lord. You shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength." And this truth you're going to teach diligently to your children when you're sitting down, when you rise up, when you walk in the way, when you lie down, essentially at every moment of every day. And so as parents, we have that responsibility to example and to explain and to expound the truths of God's word to our children. Now, God's children walked away from him. And when they did, God did not amend his character. He did not make an exception for his kids. He remained true to who he was. And in his mercy, he did what he knew he had to do to provide a way to get them out of a very bad situation. Now, when Adam and Eve did that, they literally gave to the race of humanity the genetics of disobedience. Why is it that when kids are in a grocery store, you don't have to teach them in the line to get a piece of gum and put it in their pocket or take something from the store? And when you ask them, "Hey, did you just take something off that shelf?" They go, "No." They both stole and lied. Who taught them to do that? Did parents role play how to do that at the house? No, it's innate because of the genetics of disobedience. But God wants parents to know that he knows where you're at. He knows what it's like to experience that personal rejection from your very own children. And so God looks at Abraham in Genesis and he says, "Now I'm going to tell Abraham what I'm about to do, because Abraham, he will instruct his children. He's going to become a great nation. He will instruct his children after him, and they will keep the law of the Lord." So he began to tell him about the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. And what God showed me was that Abraham was diligent to teach his children, and we must be diligent to teach our children. Abraham believed God. And his faith in God, he imparted that to his children. His influence was more than just putting bacon and bread on the table. It was, "I want to put the word of God into my children's heart." So the Bible tells us in Proverbs 22 verse 6, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." Now, that is a beautiful scripture. And most often, we love to believe that it will be true. Now, it's not often true, because sometimes kids do go astray. But I want to encourage parents today that are listening. Your kids, especially if they're still in your home, they are in basic training. Train them how to live for God, and train them how to live naturally. The reason why you should not write a hot check is because that is a financial lie. And you don't want to teach your kids how to lie financially. That's just one of those self-explanatory moments that you got to be honest in your dealings, and your children will learn by watching mom and dad. And show them how to be faithful to the house of God. You see, a long time back, I had a friend, and he had purchased a G. Loomis fishing rod, which is a very expensive top-of-the-line fishing rod. And I asked him, I said, "Man, how much that cost?" And he told me, I said, "Whoa," I said, "man, that's a lot of money." He said, "When you're passionate about something, you'll pay for it." In other words, if you're passionate, you'll pay for what you're passionate about. So show your kids how to make a way to live for God, not make an excuse of why we're not going to church or we're not living for God. They're in basic training. Train them up right. Because parents have that express requirement of being an example to tell or to show their children what is acceptable both in natural and in spiritual things. But here is the question I really want to address. What do I do? How do I treat myself or consider myself when my kids backslide? Because most often parents, when a child walks away from God, the first question you ask, "Where did I go wrong? How did I mess up in not keeping them in the faith that I've lived in front of them all these years?" Let me maybe answer a concern some of you are having right now that are listening to this. Even if you walk away from God personally, I encourage you, talk to your kids and tell them, "Listen, Dad, Mom, I made a mistake. I should have never walked away from God. And be honest with them. The truth is, your kids will understand most probably the mercies of God that are needed for every adult, for every person. Nobody is perfect, as my dad always says, and I like to mention, these are shoulder blades, not angels' wings. So we're all human, and we all need the grace and the mercy of God. And as you live a submitted life before God, hopefully and prayerfully, your children will see that and they will follow suit. And if they do depart, we serve a God who's able to recover them. He's able to bring them back. Because here is another important message I want you to hear that I felt like God directed me to. It's found in a scripture in Ezekiel chapter 14. Because here's the thing, your righteousness is the application of being right before God that God applies to you individually. So you can share a whole lot with your family. You can share your faith. You can share your testimony. You can share your wealth through your will to your children when you die. You can share a meal. But there's one thing you cannot share. And that is your righteousness with God. Your righteousness is the product of your response to a holy God, His word, His commandments. If your kids do not respond the same way you respond, you're not responsible for their actions because they will stand before God. And you say, well, where is that example in Scripture? Let me share with you. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, when the land sins against me by trespassing grievously, then will I stretch out my hand upon it and will break the staff of the bread thereof. He'll cause a famine. Will send famine upon it and will cut off man and beast from it. Though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they should deliver but their own souls by their righteousness, saith the Lord. Then the Lord mentions about noisome beast. I encourage you to go read in Ezekiel 14. He mentions about the sword. Then in the final verse, he said, if I send pestilence into that land and pour out my fury upon it in blood to cut off from it man and beast, though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, saith the Lord God, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter. They shall but deliver their own souls by their individual righteousness. What is God saying here? I feel like God is trying to bring comfort to a family, a parent, a couple whose children may have walked away from God, and you're saying, God, where did we go wrong? It's very probable that you didn't go wrong. Your children went wrong. They did not obey the word of the Lord. They didn't yield to God the way they were supposed to. And I know that that is so perplexing. And we may say, God, how could this be? Well, you cannot manipulate men to serve God. It has to be of the human will, of the human heart. Now, why would God remember Noah, Daniel, and Job? Because these three men, they stood for God and what was right in the midst of some very troubling and perplexing times. Noah lived for God through the middle of a worldwide pandemic. No, it wasn't COVID, but what he lived through covered the entire face of the earth. It was a flood, and Noah's dedication to God caused him to come out of the pandemic unscathed and saved from the effects of that pandemic. Daniel withstood political pressure like could not be imagined. Legislation was brought before the king that made it a crime to pray to anyone else except the king. The king, though he liked Daniel, he did not know this was crafty legislation meant to silence the dedication and prayer of Daniel. When Daniel heard about it, he said, I will not be silenced. Let the consequences be what they will be. I will serve God and do what is right. So he served God under intense political and government pressure. Job endured a trial of epic proportions, and yet he never cursed God. He never stopped trying to do what was right before God. In each of these, whether it's a pandemic, whether it's political pressure, whether it's a personal trial, these men tell us, you can do what's right. You can live for God in troublesome and perplexing times. I want to share with you about two precious men of the Bible. One was named Eli and another man named Samuel. Do you realize that Eli and Samuel, they played a role, an important role in reconciling Israel to God via the priesthood and being a prophet, but yet their sons were not counted among the righteous. Their sons, they ended up being sons of Belial and just wicked sons. And I bring this to your attention because I want you to know your dedication to God is important, but it really ultimately only affects you. The righteousness you create by your prayer meeting, by your sacrifice to God, by your serving God, cannot be given to your children. Give them what you will, what you want, but you can't give them your righteousness. So we have to understand that there is hope for every man. Well, my children are backslidden, but I want to tell you there's hope for backslidden children. There is hope that God can rescue them. He can bring them back and He can cause them to serve God. What should I do with my children who have walked away from God? You love them. Never stop loving them. You lead them where they will allow you to lead them. And then ultimately, you leave them in the hands of a merciful and a loving God. And I do believe that the parental influence of a parent is very powerful. And as long as you do the best you can, the best you know how, it will have a lasting impact. I'm reminded in Scripture, 2 Kings 10 tells about a young man. When Jehu was departed from a place, he lighted upon Jehonadab, the son of Rechab, coming to meet him. He saluted him and he said, "Is your heart right as my heart is with your heart?" And Jehonadab answered, "It is. If it be, give me thine hand." And he gave him his hand and he took him up in the chariot and he said, "Come with me and see my zeal, my passion for the things of God." Well, that little glimpse of a story lets us know that Jehonadab served God. Well, years later, Jeremiah, he mentions the family of Jehonadab, the son of Rechab. Look at Jeremiah chapter 35, verse 1. "The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, go to the house of the Rechabites and speak with them and bring them to the house of the Lord into one of the chambers. Then offer them wine to drink." And so you read, "Then I set before the Rechabites pitchers full of wine and cups. And I said to them, 'Drink wine.' But they answered, 'We will drink no wine. For Jonadab, the son of Rechab, our father, commanded us, saying, You shall not drink wine, neither you nor your sons forever. You shall not build a house. You shall not sow seed. You shall not plant nor have a vineyard. But you shall live in tents all the days of your life, that you may live with many days in the land where you sojourn. We have obeyed the voice of Jonadab, the son of Rechab, our father, and all that he commanded us, to drink no wine all our days, ourselves, our wives, our sons, and our daughters." The influence of a parent years later affected the lineage of that man. His sons, his daughters said, "Because our dad said, 'We will drink no wine. We will live for God. We will not entertain ourselves with things that delude or distract us from serving and being dedicated to God.'" It left a lasting impression. If I could give some hope today to precious parents and wonderful people of God, your dedication will have a lasting impact. Whether you see that impact while you're yet living or after you may have passed on, God deals with a son and a daughter or grandsons and granddaughters. He causes the tears to be poured out of the vial from heaven and he pours them upon the altar and remembers your dedication. God will stir them. God will stir them up. Their response, you've got to leave that in the hands of a loving and a merciful God. Whether they respond right or whether they reject God's offer to get right with God. That's between them and God. But if I could give comfort to you today, live for God. Love your sons and your daughters. Lead them where they will allow you to lead them. And then leave them in the hands of a God who knows how to speak a language that they can understand. And I believe God is going to help us. The measure of faith is given to every man. And God will help them to respond correctly to that impulse when God pulls and calls them. God bless you today. I pray that as you continue your dedication on a daily basis, God will give you comfort to know your dedication is affecting your life primarily, and He will allow it somehow to affect those around you. Live for God as it affects you personally, and watch God move in the lives of your family members. God bless you.
Hi, listeners. This is Scott Cooper, producer of the Parkway Podcast. That concludes the show for today. We hope you enjoyed. Remember, we offer video versions of the podcast on our Facebook and YouTube channels, as well as the audio versions on your favorite podcast provider, including Apple Podcasts and Spotify. We also encourage you to check out our website at www.parkwaychurch.net, where we offer live streaming of our services, as well as video archives, and the opportunity to give to help support this ministry so that we can continue to bring you awesome Holy Ghost-filled content each week. Thank you for listening, and please tune in to our next episode.